October of 2023, I made a video sharing my cat Katniss's experience being diagnosed with irritable bowel disease. We went through a year of incredible stress, lots of vet appointments, different treatments and tests, and finally, achieving a point of relative stability. Until the flare-up happened. Unfortunately, today I am back with an updated video to share with you our experience with Katniss's first IBD flare-up. I hope that by sharing this story, you will find something valuable in what we went through and the lessons we learned, because it is an unfortunate reality that flare-ups are part of the IBD beast, they are going to happen, and knowing both to expect that and how to react makes all the difference in the world. If you're unfamiliar with her story, Katniss is my now 6-year-old Siamese ragdoll mix who I rescued as a tiny kitten from a feral colony. She was in bad shape. I nursed her back to health. She became literally what saved me at that time, and I think we kind of saved each other. She is precious to me. There's literally nothing I wouldn't do for her. So if you're interested in the story about how Katniss came to be diagnosed with IBD and what the initial symptoms and experience was, I would highly recommend you check out that video. I'm going to start this one where that left off. So essentially, Katniss, after going through everything and receiving a diagnosis, basically stabilized. And this was really about the time I posted that video in October 2023, she was beginning to stabilize. And that just continued, that literally continued all throughout that year, all throughout the beginning of this year, until July of 2024. And really, we were not doing a ton of really abnormal things for Katniss. So she did switch to Royal Canin gastrointestinal hard food. So I completely transitioned her off all hard foods to just that one. As well, her wet food has been a combination of Royal Canin gastrointestinal along with Royal Canin adult instinctive, which is not a prescription food. And I kind of interchanged those. I never was able to successfully transition her full-time to Royal Canin gastrointestinal soft food, but this combo seemed to be working. I'm also a huge advocate of the probiotic I have literally given her every single day since the problem started back in the spring of 2023. This is something we will continue for the rest of her life. I know there's mixed research about the effectiveness of probiotics with IBD. I am only here to tell you that from our personal experience, there isn't a lot of other things we've done. This is one change, and it has worked wonders for us. I am really strict about keeping Katniss's diet consistent. I have allowed just one treat a day, the squeeze treats by Delectables, partially because I want Katniss to be able to enjoy treats and she loves them, and partially because this is how I get pills and probiotics into her when needed. So as Katniss stabilized, I feel like I began to dip my toe back into like the normal world, which if you are a pet owner dealing with this, I think you will understand that it can be so incredibly stressful. When Katniss was sick and when things were so uncertain, I did not feel like I could leave my home for any type of getaway, even a night, much less like a week or longer, because literally what if something went wrong while I was gone? It just felt so unstable. So as she begins to do better and better, I slowly began to get some of my life back. Not that she isn't my life, but you know what I mean, like doing other things. Took a couple of trips to go visit family and just felt more comfortable going out for several hours to events that I love doing. Katniss, meanwhile, was doing awesome. So at her lowest point, she was 8.9 pounds, but she gained a solid 2+ pounds and is consistently weighing in at 11 to like 11.4. I've been told by every person who's checked her weight that she is slightly overweight at this poundage, although nobody is super concerned about it. They think it's good to have maybe a tiny buffer when a cat deals with something that can affect appetite so drastically. But the bottom line is she gained weight, she held it consistently, and just her energy, and you can just tell. She feels so much better. It was such a relief. If I'm being truly honest, and not to sound cocky at all, and I am somewhat of a superstitious person, so probably should have knocked on wood when I said this, but I honestly was wondering if we had just put this behind us, that maybe it was a brief blip on the radar and that we would never again face these issues. Until the flare-up happened. And with it, you guys, lesson number one, these can happen out of the blue. So prior to this flare-up, there were really no visible signs to me from Katniss that things were not going well. And so again, I was kind of in that state of maybe we've put this behind us. And then all of the sudden, one day, I walk into my dining room and I see what looked like a hairball thrown up on the floor. And my first thought when I saw that was, I know that's not good, but I mean, cats do occasionally throw up hairballs, and I know that it's never normal, but there is an explanation for it. So I was attempting to quell the little bit of panic that kind of rose when I saw that and tell myself, it's okay. This might have worked had it not been for the fact that just a few days later, I found another one. And the difference this time is it was surrounded by a small pile of vomit. And I happened to catch it like pretty much right after she threw it up, and I was cleaning it up while she's watching me. She looks sad, she looks, you know, worried, like, Mom, am I in trouble? And as I'm cleaning it up, she immediately starts like heaving, and she threw up right in front of me. And this time it was absolutely vomit. And oh my God, you guys, one, it's awful to see your cat suffering, and two, immediately, like the panic that I thought I had buried, that was gone, comes flooding back. Like, is this, are we going back to like last year? And I think that's what really, really, really surprised me is, this is, I guess, lesson number two, the feelings come rushing back really quickly. So all the anxiety, all the concern, I mean, it's like it never left. It came back really intensely just watching that one moment. Later in the day, I did notice in her litter box, there was some diarrhea. And I mean, the bigger sign is she clearly was lethargic, was not feeling well, was laying around, not eating. I mean, immediately, like, I knew I had to act. I knew that I wasn't gonna let any time pass, and I had to jump right on this. So jump right on this to me meant two things. Number one, I have meds that I keep around the house for her that have always been for in case this happens. So I have Serenia, which is like an anti-nausea tablet. And then I have Miritaz, which is an appetite stimulant. We have the version where you can rub it like in the inner ear. And this was very intentional because I had always thought if these symptoms come back, I can treat them before I get her into a vet, which by the way is the second main thing, is make a vet appointment. Well, here comes the third lesson. Katniss and I had gone so long without an issue that I had let the prescriptions expire. Didn't realize I had, but I had. So I had them in my cabinet, but I found them and the expiration date is months past. And I'm like, oh my God, because this is literally like right before the 4th of July weekend. And immediately I'm thinking, okay, I'm not gonna be able to get a refill. I'm not gonna be able to get into a vet. I've gotta call somebody quickly before this holiday weekend. And so I guess the third lesson here is, don't let your prescriptions lapse. Even when things are going well, make a note to yourself on the calendar or somewhere to check in on them during those dates. Because when they lapsed, I immediately call my vet and I called the specialist first and I asked, is it okay to still give an expired prescription? I wasn't really planning on it, but I did want to know. But the answer I got was basically that likely it wouldn't do harm, but that's not for sure. And most likely what would happen is that it would just be less effective. I'm not going to deal in most likely and buts and possibilities with Katniss's health. So the old prescriptions were out. The real bummer here is the specialist told me they would just not renew them. They would renew the Miritaz, the appetite stimulant, but not the Serenia. We needed to come in for another appointment to get a renewal of that, which threw me off. And also, of course, they're backed up. So I'm really starting to panic here. Fortunately, because initially Katniss and I had been in and out of her normal vet and also a specialist, I was able to call the normal vet and they did agree to renew the Serenia prescription we'd gotten from them. And that was largely due to the fact Katniss is up to date on shots and wasn't due for another appointment yet. So thank God. But again, don't put yourself in the position where it's even a question about your prescriptions. Make sure to note the dates. Make sure to always have something on hand that is not expired. And never, ever, ever risk giving your cat expired medication because you just don't know the effects. And the possibilities are actually kind of scary about what might happen. So as I mentioned, the specialist was really booked up. I think the first time I could get in was like 10 days from the day I called. So of course I take that appointment and I ask them, could you please put me on a waiting list if somebody cancels? I'd like to be notified. I'm taking what I can get at this point. I also called her normal vet who was booked up as well and took the first available appointment there. My preference in a perfect world was to get right into the specialist because I have learned that the normal vet basically can treat the symptoms and then they're gonna refer you out anyway. But if it really came down to it, I'm going to the first place I can get in to make sure she's okay with fluids, with, you know, having her eating good. So not knowing which would pan out, I took both. So as it turns out, the specialist is the first one we can get into. We didn't get an earlier appointment, but we were able to last those 10 days prior to the appointment because of the refilled Serenia and Miritaz. And that experience was, again, a slow, gradual return of Katniss's appetite. I gave her, I believe, 5 or 6 different days worth of Serenia, like right in a row. And I never did use the appetite stimulant, which is a blessing, because she did start slowly eating again. And one thing I've gotten much better at is not panicking because of one day of not eating, and in fact, not trying to force her if she does not feel well. I know that a cat not eating for a long period of time is dangerous, but I used to think that even a day couldn't be handled. But if your cat is not feeling great, I've learned by talking to vets and doing research that it is okay that day when they're not feeling great to kind of not force that and not panic about it. So by the time we get into the specialist, Katniss is on the uphill climb, or Katniss is doing better is what I'm trying to say. She is starting to rebound. And the specialist does a normal exam. I tell her what happened. She checks weight. She reviews the chart. She does remember us. And essentially the message that I get from her is she's really not worried about it. She told me that flare-ups are going to happen. It is unfortunately a part of IBD. She said if it's happening, as in Katniss's case, like once every 6 months, and generally speaking, the cat is rebounding in a couple of days, you don't even need to come in and see me again. She said when she would be concerned is if it's happening maybe monthly, and or the cat is taking 3 to 4 days to regain appetite and kind of lethargic that whole time. That is when she said she'd want to see Katniss again, and that is when she said we would really, really need to consider the biopsy. I told you in my first video, we opted not to do the surgical biopsy of Katniss's colon for many reasons. One of the biggest ones for me is a fear of anesthesia and what it does to Katniss. We have previous experience with this. It's very invasive. And also the vet's advice that regardless of what its result would be, the treatment would not vary much, if at all. And so she thought it made more sense to try our diet modifications, see how things go, and then make that decision. I had learned from the Helpful Vancouver Vets YouTube videos, which again, I recommend highly because I found them extremely helpful and really easy to digest, that there is such thing as a non-invasive biopsy that a vet can do that still gives them the full picture of what's going on in the colon. And I did find out by talking to my vet that this is an option there, and I was so relieved to hear that. So if indeed we come down to needing to do a biopsy, that is the route we're going. And thank God there's a place near us that can do it, because I got the impression that it's not super, super common, but it is possible 2 things have advanced since he made that video. And anyway, I'm just so relieved. Okay, so a few other things that the vet and I talked about, which you may find helpful or may not. I remember saying that the flare-up seemed to come out of the blue, and it really did feel that way. And I was really racking my brain to think what could have triggered this, if anything. So there's one thing that we were doing that I didn't really explain well, which is occasionally I would give Katniss a can of Royal Canin kitten soft food. Now, this is something that I picked up from one of the families I pet sit for. They have a severely underweight elderly cat whose appetite frequently diminishes, and their vet had suggested to them kitten food because it's higher in calories, and he just thought that would be good for that particular cat. When Katniss was first diagnosed and she was going through long periods of time of not eating, I thought, why not try kitten food? We were in that experimental stage, and I just knew about the calorie thing. So I did occasionally give her some, and she loved it. It was interesting. And never did it seem to bother her. And I did ask my vet about it on a couple of different occasions, and basically I was told it's not something that you want to do long term. It is not a regular solution, but if she's not reacting poorly to it and she enjoys it, it's okay occasionally. And so occasionally that's what I would do. It had never caused an issue. And in fact, I actually had an animal rescuer friend of mine say she was surprised it hadn't, but it had never. I will say, however, that slightly before this flare-up, I had given her some kitten food, and I am wondering if there's a connection. Regardless, in discussing it with the specialist, we've decided to eliminate the kitten food possibility moving forward. So another interesting thing I learned is that the diet Katniss is on, the Royal Canin Gastrointestinal specifically, that is a prescription food, is not an IBD diet. And this entire time I have been under the impression that it is. We did get a prescription for it early on in her, issues last year, and I guess that's why I always assumed it was IBD related, and now when I look back and the timing of that, I think we got that prescription before we got our diagnosis, and the vet was just trying to try things that might help settle her system. So all this time I thought I had transitioned her to an IBD specific diet, but no, really, apparently the gastrointestinal food is just easier to digest. Regardless, it is working, and the vet has absolutely no concern. The specialist has absolutely no concern about what Katniss is doing. She basically told me, if it is working, there's no need to change it. And she kind of reminded me that along the way with this disease, things can stop working and you may have to modify them. But it's, you know, thank God we have some stability. It's just an interesting thing. Like, all along I thought I was doing something IBD related, and it is not. And the last thing she told me during that appointment is that the fact Katniss has been doing relatively, like, so well, like, one flare-up, yes, but long periods of time doing well, eating, maintaining weight, leads her to believe by this point that Katniss's situation is less likely to be small cell lymphoma. So again, that's the point of doing the surgical biopsy, is to make sure what you're dealing with, whether it's IBD or small cell lymphoma, which could present much like IBD. And so you don't really know until you do the biopsy for sure, but the vet is pretty confident in saying that because we've gone nearly a year now with very little issues, that leads her to believe it is more likely for certain IBD rather than the small cell lymphoma. So that was basically it for our appointment. It was, just generally speaking, reassuring. It made me feel like maybe along the way I've learned something, as I didn't panic quite as much as I did the first time around. Yes, initially I did, but it was comforting and reassuring to revisit the specialist and to know that I now know enough where I feel like I can have a conversation with her and digest a lot of the information, and I really appreciated that. I also think I've learned a lot about vets, I guess bedside manner, for lack of better words, and I so appreciate the care and attentiveness that both the specialist and Katniss's regular vet have shown. In my past, I've definitely had experiences with awful veterinarians, and I've had veterinarians that are not awful, but that you don't ever leave feeling like they care much. But both of these have been absolutely on the other end of the spectrum. They have just made us feel very valued, very cared for, and just very loved. And so just thank you. So the fourth and final lesson is something that I've only recently just done, and I've found it to be so incredibly helpful. I didn't even realize that there were Facebook groups specific to IBD kitties, but indeed there are, and I highly recommend you join them and read the posts and interact with the people in the groups. I've always been an advocate of gathering information from a variety of sources because I think it just helps deepen your knowledge base, and the more knowledge you have, the easier things are to deal with. The Facebook groups, I think I've found to be literally the most helpful source of knowledge because it is so many people describing relatively the same things, and you see common themes, and I find that very comforting. And a couple things that I take from them is there's no right solution that works for every cat. There are generalities that are true, but there are cats in there and their owners report they're eating stuff like Fancy Feast or Sheba still. Not everybody switched to prescription. Some of them are on a lot of medicines. Some of them are on no medicines. Everybody's experience is different. And actually just knowing that helps me to feel better. Because I remember early on in our experience, I kept thinking, we're not doing this right. I'm not doing it exactly like the vet has recommended. Katniss won't abide by that. Like, we're gonna fail. And really, there's no such thing as fail here. It is trial and error. It is doing what works for your cat. It is keeping yourself educated. It is unfortunately accepting that these relapses are part of the deal, but knowing how to tackle them and knowing the best moves to make and the things to stay up to date on really make all the difference in the world. So guys, as I end this, Katniss, by the way, is doing great. We did rebound from the flare-up, and she has been holding her own since then, so I'm so relieved. I guess just a final little bonus lesson is I would recommend nobody ever take a single day with these precious fur babies for granted. You just don't know what the next day brings, you don't know what this disease brings, and in the moment, when they're happy, when they want to play with you, when they want to snuggle with you, even when they want to annoy you, soak it in for all it's worth, because there may come a day where that's not happening anymore, and that will be devastating. And so while you have a chance to make the good memories, make the good memories. And frankly, guys, this is true whether your cat has IBD or nothing at all. Their time on this earth is relatively so short and precious. Soak in every moment. It is well worth it. Thank you so much for listening to my video and Katniss's updated experience with her IBD. If more continues to happen, we will absolutely keep you updated. If you have questions or want to share your experience, drop a comment below, and we will see you in our next video.